Welcome, everybody. Hello. Good morning to you on this important Sunday. My daughter, Alice, who's 10, said to me this morning over the phone, "What does lest we forget mean?" Because I'd said lest we forget, which is an important Remembrance Day phrase that we use. Now, lest we forget is not something that makes sense to lots of young people, which doesn't mean that we can start forgetting. It just means that in order to communicate the importance of Remembrance Day with the younger generations, maybe we can start using different language. If the Bible is okay to be translated linguistically and verbally, it's also okay to translate it culturally. If the gospel needs to be translated from Koine Greek in the New Testament into modern day English, then it's okay also to change some of the methods and the forms that we use in order to do that. Because, of course, the key thing in lest we forget is the not forgetting. It's not the phrase lest we forget. So we move on to today's question. And what a privilege it is. I am a comedian, I'm a preacher, I'm an apologist. I do lots of things. Post-pandemic, I'll do anything to make money. I mean, I'm not even a Christian, I was free, so I am a Christian, obviously, which is good. I'm a bald man, that's why Mark's invited me, a bald man. You can tell how Mark feels about people with hair, because he's obviously punished Rapunzel quite a while. So what happens if you have long hair in this church? You're just quite lucky you've got off scot-free. So, the question is Jesus the only way to God? There's another question like, what's wrong with that baby? That's another question as well. But today's question for us, is Jesus the only way to God? What would our initial feelings be? Yes. Yes. And if you want the short answer, yes. There's a few things I want to unpack, though. Because nobody in our society, particularly of the younger generations coming up, nobody is asking that question with those words. Nobody is asking us, is Jesus the only way to God? People aren't really asking questions in that way, because Christianity is no longer the sort of centralized monolith in our society. So people are no longer comparing Christianity to everything else. In the 1960s, when the Beatles went all weird and New Age, that's when those questions, is Christianity still the only way to God? But now people aren't asking those questions. People are now asking questions. They're not even saying what is true. The question isn't even any longer what is true, but what is truth? What does it mean for anything to be true? So the question, if you want to know the answer, is Jesus the only way to God? Yes. And it's great for us as Christians to know that, so that we can have confidence in sharing the gospel. But confidence in sharing the gospel doesn't give us the right ability to share the gospel. In the same way, you could blindfold yourself and line up a row of, you could go to Meadow Lane or the City Ground and line up a row of footballs on the edge of the 16-yard box, blindfold yourself and just belt them wildly. Occasionally, you would score a goal. That doesn't mean that you're a good free kick taker. So having confidence and passion in sharing the gospel is great. Maybe the best thing. But if we can find ways to better communicate the gospel, to better respond to the questions that people are actually asking, then we'll be more effective. We'll score more free kicks than we miss. Obviously, Forest don't score any free kicks at the moment, but you know, that's a different point. So, is Jesus the only way to God? There's a lot in that, isn't there? It's not just simply a question of Jesus, but of God. And when we say to people, Jesus is the only way to God, most people might well ask, well, I don't know, what is God? Who is God? I don't know anything about God. If it's okay for Jesus to be the only way for God, but if we don't know what God is like, then we might not want to go there. It's like you saying to me, Andy, the best way to Mansfield is the A60. I don't want to go to Mansfield. And with good reason. I've been there before, I didn't like it. So telling people the right way to God is only half the issue. It's only half the solution. We have to actually encourage them that that's a place that they want to go to. I mean, obviously, if I go up to Mansfield, I might be able to go off to Centre Parks, and that's fantastic. I want that. Sherwood Pines, I love it. I don't want to just go to Mansfield. So we've actually got to captivate people with the why, not just the how. So yes, Jesus is the only way to God. And I'll say it at the end, and I want to give an example at the end of what God is like. But it's when people say, Jesus isn't the only, there's many ways to God. People don't understand what they're talking about. And that isn't some sort of self-exalting Christian bias. Do you know that nobody else is offering you a way to God? None of the other worldviews, religions, or philosophies are actually offering you a way to God. When Jesus says, another fallen life. I hope that's not prophetic. When Jesus says, no one comes to the Father but through me, he's not being arrogant. Nobody else is offering you a way to the Father. Nobody else is offering you a way to God. In every other religion, at best, the way you get to God is by doing all the things that you are supposed to do according to that religion. And even then, you have no guarantee. Muhammad, the founder of Islam, said, I do not know what will happen to me. Talking about salvation and going to heaven, he said, I do not know what will happen to me. The founder of Islam wasn't sure that he'd lived a good enough life in order to get to heaven. And even if he had, in Islam, the view of heaven is not the view that we have of heaven, of the presence of God and joy and freedom. The Islamic view of heaven is wine and women, which is fantastic if you're a pirate from the 1700s. But what if you're somebody who struggled with alcohol dependency? What if you're a single parent from Chesterfield? That might be true, but that's not a good story. That's not a place that I want to go. And that most people in this room would want to go. So there's these two things. What is true, and why should we want it to be true? So what I like to do when I'm talking to people, rather than saying, this is true, this is what you need to believe, what I like to do is to build common ground. I want to help us to be able to build some common ground. The way I do it is with the concept of little story and big story. Little story is our shared human experience, and the big story is whatever is true out there. I've been a Christian for 20 years, I've been an evangelist for a lot of that, and I've made plenty of mistakes. Now, however capable I am now, as an evangelist, as a preacher, it's only because I've tried to learn from the thousands of mistakes that I've made. There's no hierarchy in the kingdom. Like, we're always trying to learn and to grow and to get better, always making mistakes. We were talking this morning, Mark, about how we've had to learn from quite big mistakes. I won't mention any of yours, but, you know, thanks for writing them down for me. The book's coming out next year. Deplatforming Mark Hopkins. So what I like to do, because, you know, in the past, I've when I first became a Christian, I wanted to talk to people about healing and miracles, because I've seen some people be healed. I was at a festival in Chesterfield when I lived in Chesterfield, which is it's a great place to be. I love the Crooked Spire. There's a church there, set up a Christian bakery called Baguette Behind Me Satan. It's a really nice place. That's not true. I was at this campsite in Chesterfield, and it was a Christian festival, and this woman twisted her knee and fell over. And I was working as an evangelist for Redeemer King Church, and I went over, and I was trying to grow in the gifts of the Spirit. I've got as many questions as answers about that, but I was trying to grow. The Bible says that when Christians pray, stuff happens, because that's when God shows up. So whether we understand it or not, it's okay to pray for healing, even if we don't see the healing. We're allowed to pray for it. So I prayed for this, we'll put my hand on her knee, and I said, in the name of Jesus, knee be healed, all pain go now. Prayer, healing prayer 101. And I felt absolutely nothing. But this woman had told me that her knee had twisted before, and she'd been out of action for 6 weeks. She'd need to go to the hospital with gas and air. And on this occasion, although I felt nothing, she said she felt an energy like a fluid enter her body through her head, pass through her body, pass through her knee, take all the pain away. She got up, she was perfectly mobile, and she's still healed today. And I used to love to talk about that, because I think that's a great story. Bringing the power of God into you know, Derbyshire life. The problem is that when I talked to people about that, they would just say, well, that sounds like Harry Potter to me, Andy. I don't think you're lying per se, but I have no frame of reference for what you've just described. I don't know what you're talking about. I've never experienced this. You want me to change my entire worldview because you've had a Hogwarts experience. You've learned a spell. That's how it comes across. Or in the past, I would have been very zealous about the Bible, which is good to be. I believe the Bible. I believe it's true. You are a word and spirit church, and you can't have one without the other. Whatever God is doing in prayer, whatever God is doing in the real world, it never contradicts his word. God never does anything in the world that he doesn't say he's going to do in the word. So we agree on those things. And I used to try to convince people that the Bible was relevant and trustworthy and true. And I might be quite good about that. I might be quite good at that because I've read the Bible and I've read stuff about, critical theory and literary theory and stuff like that. But again, what people used to say to me was, one person said on one particular occasion, Andy, thanks. What you've done is you've at least showed me that some of the lies I believed about the Bible I can get rid of. But still, the very most that you have done is proved to me that a couple of thousand years ago, a small group of men believed Jesus had been risen from the dead and were very good at convincing people about that. It doesn't actually mean that Jesus was raised from the dead. That's the response I tended to get. And I thought, hang on, there's something here that's being missed. For all my aptitude and my passion and my willingness, I'm not getting results. I'm not seeing people soften. And part of the problem was that with both these things, I'm inserting an unnecessary middleman. I'm trying to use something that my friends haven't experienced and have no knowledge of to prove to them that something else they haven't experienced and have no knowledge of is the big story that the universe is telling. I was trying to take them through a process. And actually, it can just be a bit bewildering for people. So, I keep it simple, and this is what I want to offer us today. Let me be clear. It's okay to pray for healing. It's good. It's good to talk about those stories and share them. It's also good to believe that the Bible is true and can be trusted and to share that. But maybe we do that a little bit further down the line. This is what I encourage people to do. Big story, little story. Our little story is based on the idea that we are all made in the image of God. We are image bearers. Now, what that means is that there are certain things that every single human being agrees on. And we can build a common ground with people. The questions that human beings have always asked throughout time are the same. The big three questions: origin, purpose, destiny. Wherever you're from or whenever you're from, these are the questions that people, that humanity has always asked. Origin, purpose, destiny. Where did I come from? Why am I here? What happens afterwards? And we all have a shared human experience. There's certain things. When I went searching for meaning at the age of 22, the reason I became a Christian was because I found a big story that matched my little story. My little story is the same as yours. It's the same as the people who live on this road. It's the same as your work colleagues, your Crown Green Bowls colleagues. I'm just playing the audience here. And your friends. And here are some of the things that we all agree on. Number one, and after that, we'll see which big story, if any, makes sense of the little story. Love is the first one. It's the big one. If you only do one, you focus on love. Not just love, but unconditional love. Everybody that you know believes in unconditional love. And I'll explain what I mean by that. What I mean is that everybody wants to be loved unconditionally. Most people know what unconditional love means. If you've got family, if you've got kids, you love them unconditionally. You might not like them very much the whole time, but you love them unconditionally. Everybody you know believes in unconditional love. And you notice, you recognize unconditional love by its absence as much as by its presence. Feeling rejected shows that you believe in love, because rejection is the opposite of loving acceptance. It's the same with some of the other things that we all agree on. We all believe in freedom. We all want to be free. No one wants to feel trapped, because trapped is the absence of freedom. Everybody you know wants to be free, believes in freedom. Everybody you know wants to be loved unconditionally, and often knows what it means to love unconditionally. Everybody wants purpose. Everyone believes in purpose. You want your life to be about something, to go somewhere. You want to leave a legacy. You want to leave something behind. You want to be remembered. All of these things are about purpose. You believe in justice. Everyone you know believes in justice. Another way we could describe that is objective morality. The idea that some things really are wrong and some things really are right. Now, we might disagree on exactly what is right and exactly what is wrong. Everybody in this room, I hope, disagrees with Vladimir Putin. But Vladimir Putin doesn't have no sense of justice. He just has a warped sense of justice. But he absolutely believes that certain things are right and is willing to try and make those things happen. We would disagree. But that sense of justice, what we also might call the human rights urge, the idea that people, maybe not all people, but people as people are valuable, everybody agrees on that. We all agree that death feels unnatural. Whether you die at 92 years of age or 9 weeks, death feels unnatural. People say, oh, death's just a part of life. It doesn't feel that way when someone you love or you know goes. It feels unnatural. There's other things as well, but we just start with those. Everybody we know agrees with those experiences. You know what joy and hope feel like. You and I might hope for different things and find joy in different things, but they feel the same. You could describe the feeling of hope and I'd know what you were talking about. I'd know the sensation, same with joy. It's because we're made in the image of God. We're made in the image of a God who has wired into us the capacity to experience and feel and know these things. Now, that doesn't get us to the cross, obviously, because people will then say, I was doing this gig in Bath. This guy came up to me at the end of my gig, and he said, I liked your show. You're a funny man. I didn't like the bit where you said that Jesus was the only way to God. I find that very exclusive. I said, I agree, it's exclusive. He said, well, I am a Buddhist, and I believe that there are many ways to God. I said, that's great. In a way, I hope that's true, because that would save a lot of argument. That would be convenient. Describe this God to me, I said. Describe this God to me. What is God like? In your mind, I said, what is God like? He said, what is the stuff that you were talking about? He's love and peace and freedom. He actually said, he or she or it is love and peace and freedom and joy. I said, that's great, Charlie, for 'twas his name. I said, that's great, Charlie. I agree that God is all of those things. I said, you have one problem there, though, Charlie. As a Buddhist, you haven't described the God of Buddhism. You've described Jesus Christ and nobody else. And this is not Christian bias. We have to be able to honor people of other worldviews, other beliefs. The ground level for Christians is to love your enemies. People who disagree with us are not our enemies. So if we love our enemies, what do we do with people who just disagree a bit? But honoring other people doesn't mean saying, oh, everything's the same. Everything must be the same. Tolerance is not love. I can tolerate violence by doing nothing about it. That's tolerance. Love does something. Love looks like something. What we need to do is to understand that all religions are not superficially different but fundamentally the same. It's the opposite. All religions are superficially the same but fundamentally different. Just take Buddhism, for instance. Buddhism, you cannot say about Buddhism that it contains a god of love, because there is no god in Buddhism. Buddha himself was a man who lived and died and is yet to be resurrected. But Buddha was agnostic, which means he wasn't sure whether there was a god or not. Some Buddhists believe in a god, some don't. But you don't need to believe in God to be a Buddhist. So to say all religions contain a god of love, well, that's instantly not true, because there isn't a god of love in Buddhism. And it's the same with these Eastern religions, Hinduism, a lot of the pagan stuff, the New Age stuff. There is no personal God to love you. I said if you only use one, you do it with love. The reality is this. There is only one big story out there where your little story of wanting to be loved unconditionally receives a yes and amen. There's one big story out there where it says that God loves you unconditionally, and that is the story of Jesus. That's the story of Christianity. Christianity might still be false, but it's the only story where your desire to love unconditionally and to be loved unconditionally makes any sense. Because, you know, you can't give away what you haven't got. If God doesn't have the capacity to love unconditionally, how has he managed to give us that capacity? The fact we're made in the image of God means that we should be able to draw a line from our little story to a big story, and it should make sense. And even just starting with love. In the Quran, for instance, I'm not making this up. In the Quran, it says Allah loves not the unbelievers. If Islam is true, and it might be, any of these stories might be true. We can be humble enough in our conversations. Having a confidence is not the same as being brash and arrogant. But if Islam is true, then everyone in this room and most people in this nation are in a lot of trouble because God doesn't love us. Imagine what that does for your mental health. Not to just disbelieve in a God of love, but to know that there's a God who doesn't love you. Wow, wowzers, trousers. That's not in the Quran, that's my phrase. There is no other story where God loves you unconditionally. It just doesn't exist. There's no personal God in these Eastern religions. And only a person can love. I don't love my phone. I like it, I need it, it's useful to me. It gets me home. It's the only way home. I don't love it because it's not a person. To say that all religions contain a God of love is just simply not true, because there is no God of love. There is no personal God to love you. So on that basis, we can just say, look, if the only thing you say to people is, look, do you believe in love? Do you believe in unconditional love? Do you want to be loved unconditionally? And they say yes. They say, well, great. You say, great. There's one story out there where you can be, where you can know that you are. There's one story. There's one story where you can know, free. You can really experience freedom. How many gods tell you they love you unconditionally? One. How many gods tell you that you really can experience peace and joy and freedom now and then fuller and fuller into eternal life? One. How many gods tell you that you should think that death feels unnatural because it wasn't meant to be that way and it won't be that way in the end? One. How many gods tell you that you should believe that some things are really wrong, but the good news is that at the end, he will wipe every tear and he will put things right that once went wrong, and everything will be put back in its place? How many gods tell you that? One. It's all the same God. It's Jesus Christ. So the way I share my story, the way I share the gospel is by saying, look, this is our little story. Where are the things that we agree on? Let's find the things that we agree on, that we really desire. And then let's see if there's a big story that makes sense of that little story. And there's one big story that makes sense of our little story. By the way, I've got a book with me. A lot of what I've just said is taken from this book, Hidden in Plain Sight, which Mark has said I'm allowed to bring and to sell. Obviously, I unpack it a bit more, but it's still a very short and very funny book, which is very helpful for you to read and also to give away to people. So I will be selling that. I'll be somewhere in the building. Will I be at that table, do you think, Mark? I'll be at that table. I'll be selling them. They're £5 in the shops, but because we're in Nottingham, we'll say £10 a copy today. No, we'll say £3 or 2 for £5. I've got a card machine as well because I live in the future like Buck Rogers. So £3, 2 for £5. Very much big story, little story. Explains to you what different religions and worldviews actually believe and offers the gentle argument, persuasion, that Christianity is still the best story out there. It makes the best sense of what we know. And it's that. Telling people what is true doesn't convince them that they want to be part of that story. Telling people that something is a true story doesn't mean that they want to be part of it. The question, as I said at the start, isn't really, is Jesus the only way to God? But why would you want to go there if he is? What is God like? Jesus says in John's Gospel, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. No one else is offering to take you to God. No other religion is offering to take you to God. You don't get to the source. Although in Buddhism and Hinduism, you do get to the source, but you are obliterated. Gandhi, one of the greatest men who ever lived, said, it is an unbroken torture to me that I do not know my creator. An unbroken torture, I do not know my creator. Gandhi was expecting to live through hundreds and hundreds of extra reincarnations, the only common denominator for which was his own personal suffering, until he reached his great reward, which was the snuffing out of the candle of desire, which is the good news of Hinduism, the snuffing out of the candle of desire. It's extinction. It may be a blissful extinction, but it's extinction. The person that you're talking to, the person that you are, no longer exists in that scenario. That might be true, but that's not good news, friends. That's not a good story. That's not a story that people want to live. People want to feel like they are important, that they, as unique entities, have value. You don't get it anywhere else apart from the gospel. So not only can we be confident in the gospel and confident about sharing the gospel, we should want to. Not so we can prove that we're right and they're wrong, but because there really is a good news story that they know that they want. They might not know that they're sinners. They might not know what sin is. I'm not sure I know, really, what it's supposed to mean. They might not know that they're sinners, but they know what they desire. They know what good news looks like. And you have it. And nobody else does. So raise your heads up and share good news. Not so you can win an argument, but so that people will find you in heaven and say, I just want to say thank you for sharing that story, that best story, that good news story. And this is what God is like, and we'll finish on this. Do buy my book, £3, 2 for £5. I've also got some snake oil, if you want to buy that. You want to know what God is like? You want to know why Christianity is exclusive? Because my friend again said to me, I find Jesus being the only way to God is exclusive. It is exclusive because it excludes every worldview where the creator of the universe doesn't say you're worth dying for. It excludes every worldview where your cries of pain go either unheard or unheeded. You should want to exclude those views. You should want to exclude any story where you are not valuable, not worth dying for, not loved unconditionally. That's why Christianity is exclusive. Because it says do one to all these terrible paltry stories where human beings are just not that important. So you should happily exclude anything where you are not of ineffable value. This is what God is like. At the end of the final chapter of the final gospel, Peter has obviously denied Jesus three times. It was a terrible thing that he did. He was a coward, a moral failure, and a liar, because he'd said to the Lord, nothing could happen to you, Lord, and if it does, I'll stay with you. Wrong, P45. At the end of John's gospel, Jesus has obviously, the resurrection's happened, but the guys are still in sort of shock, and they've gone fishing. Do you remember Jesus said, I'll make you a fisher of men? Well, he's gone back to fishing because it's the only thing he knew. You need to understand that there's such a sense of despondency in these guys because they are the greatest fools in history at this point. And they go back to fishing and they don't catch anything. He can't even catch fish. He can't even fish for fish at this point, let alone men. And then the Lord appears on the beach and says, have you caught anything? They say, no, we've been out all night. We've caught nothing. And Jesus says, have you thought about putting the net on the other side of the boat? Again, he doesn't say you need to sail to the other cove or you need a bigger boat. It's not Jaws. Just one little change of direction. And that's what repentance is. It's just change your mind. Turn around. One little change. The hope you have in the gospel is right. Maybe there's just one little change in how we talk about it. Take the net, put it on the other side of the boat. And then they catch all the fish in the entire world. That's not in the text, but I like the drama of it. And then Peter sees it's the Lord, and he gets out of the boat and he races to him. And this is what God is like. Jesus meets the person who was his right-hand man, his best friend, the man who betrayed him, who had the opportunity three times to say, yes, I know him, and he denied him three times. Jesus has said to Peter, if you want to be my disciple, pick up your cross and follow me. He didn't. Deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow me. Peter didn't deny himself. He denied Jesus. He didn't pick up his cross. He fled from the cross. He did the opposite of what God had told him to do. That is the most diametrically disobedient thing you can do. You need to understand who Peter was. He was not basically a good person. He was a coward and a moral failure. And he did exactly the opposite of what the Lord face to face to him had said. And this is what God is like. Jesus meets him on the beach and he doesn't say, oh, look who it is. Come back, have you? Mr. Rejecto. He didn't get passive aggressive with him. He didn't suggest he go on a course of Christian counseling. He didn't force him into some kind of rehabilitation. He said, Peter, do you love me? Peter says, yes. Jesus says, Peter, do you love me? You know I love you. Peter, do you love me? Three affirmations to override the three rejections. Peter rejects Jesus three times. Jesus affirms Peter three times. You want to know what God is like? That's what God is like. God meets the people who really have done real things wrong, even when they've known the joy of the Lord. And he doesn't say, well, fail. Sorry, mate. So many minor faults, couple of major faults. Wait 6 months to take your test again. Do you love me, he says. Peter says, yes. And Jesus essentially says, right, well, we go again then, don't we? The deal's still on. God doesn't need your help. He just needs your yes. He doesn't need your moralism or your moral living. He just needs your yes. He wants relationship. If you're still in, so is he. If you want love and joy and hope and freedom, you can have it and you can have it now. There is no interview process. It's a yes. And we can go out into the world and know that at any point people are just so welcome. It says at the front there, welcome. They are welcome. They don't need to be living a good life. Peter was terrible. He was an idiot. Peter, do you love me? Yes, well, we're still on then. We go again. Come on. Post-pandemic, the world has changed, but God's offer to you, God's offer to our friends and neighbors and family is still the same. Is Jesus the only way to God? You better hope that he is. There are not many ways to God, and honestly, you wouldn't want there to be, and neither would your friends. We have the privilege of sharing not just truth, with a capital T, but a really good story. A good story where the things that people really desire, the things people really desire, to be loved unconditionally, to be known, not to be rejected, to be offered hope and joy and freedom and purpose. We have that story and we have the privilege of sharing it. You don't need skills. You just need an open heart. You need humility. And you need the confidence to be able to share it. 1 Peter 3:15 says, always be prepared to give a reason for the hope that is in you, but with gentleness and respect. We don't need to shout at people. We don't need to tell people to avoid Mansfield. We're drawing them into the best story ever told. The only story where our little story is fitted like a glove by a big story. It's the story of Jesus. Buy my book, £3. 2 for 5. Amen. Amen to the previous bit.